PFAS, aka forever chemicals, are everywhere in the environment, and water reclamation facilities bear the burden of receiving these compounds even though they don't generate them. To understand what this challenge means for water treatment plants and how this impacts the biosolids they generate, I sat down with Eric Spargimino. He's a leading expert in this field, and he shared his findings on the impacts to management costs and how PFAS fingerprinting can help identify PFAS at its source. Check it out.
It's our job to, as environmental engineers and just stewards of the environment, to protect it. And same as our utilities and our whether they're industrial or municipal partners, it's their job to protect the environment too. But we need to do that with a science-based approach. There's a lot of fear going around right now about PFAS. So we need to advance the science to really understand how can we mitigate this problem properly. So to do that, we need to understand what are our sources. And to do that, we need to do some of these sampling programs that a lot of utilities are already starting. And we also need to understand the toxicology of a lot of these compounds and how they migrate through the environment, the fate and transport through the environment, which a lot of the R&D that CDM Smith is doing already is progressing. And it's amazing to see some of this research emerge that we're able to take advantage of and bring to our clients to help. There are so many benefits to be gained from water reclamation facilities, whether it's these fertilizers that we produce in biosolids or energy that water reclamation facilities can produce. We need to continue to take advantage of those because, like in the case of biosolids, we have a finite amount of phosphorus in the world and it's dwindling, and biosolids contains phosphorus. So to think about trying to destroy biosolids and not beneficially reuse it is kind of crazy to me, because we need to take advantage of that fertilizer. Phosphorus is one of the three key components of life on Earth. And knowing that we have that finite amount, we have to continue to use it. So we need to understand how to safely use those biosolids.
You mentioned the cost to manage. I know you've done extensive cost analysis research on this entire topic. Can you tell me more about your research and what you found?
Sure. So in 2021, we worked with WEF and NEBRA to develop a cost study. So we surveyed 28 facilities across the country, and we said, you know, what have your biosolids management costs or what's happened to them? So from 2018, which is about when PFAS really hit the map for water reclamation, to 2021, we finished the study. We said, what's happened to your management costs? And we saw a 72% average increase in just end use costs. So that's the cost leaving the gate to whatever that facility's end use would be. Since then, we've seen even more dramatic increases. In Maine, where there's a moratorium on land application, we've seen up to 300% increase. In other states, like even some facilities in Massachusetts, smaller facilities, they've seen really dramatic 200% increases. And that's before even having regulations in place. So we're really starting to see really dramatic impacts to these utilities.
If you're enjoying this conversation and would like to learn more from the brightest minds in environment and infrastructure, please like and subscribe. PFAS research is evolving by the day. Click the link in the description to subscribe to our Breaking Down PFAS newsletter for the latest info from the front lines of treatment right to your inbox. Okay, back to Eric. How exactly can a water reclamation facility figure out where the PFAS is coming from? Are there ways to do that? And would that knowledge help them in the future?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's sort of two camps right now of, do I test or don't I test? There is the fear that if I test, now I know I have a problem and I'll have to do something about it. But in talking to a handful of different state regulators, they encourage testing. And in the absence of a limit or a regulation, a lot of this testing isn't reportable. So we're similarly encouraging utilities to, you know, find out what if there is a problem before regulations are in place. So that way you can get ahead of the game and really understand how severe the problem is, because source identification is really going to be the most cost-effective approach. Because if you can knock it out upstream of the plant in its most concentrated form by something simple like a best management practice, like putting on a carbon filter, or maybe you collect it and send it offsite for treatment rather than putting it in the collection system where now it's diluted with potentially several million gallons a day of flow, and it's going to be a lot harder to treat.
So is that kind of the same idea of PFAS fingerprinting?
Yeah. So great question. Part of what CDM Smith has learned through our R&D and some ongoing projects is through this upstream sampling programs that we've developed for a handful of clients, we can actually look at the spread of PFAS compounds and develop a fingerprint for things like if we see a particular fingerprint, which is that spread of PFAS compounds and different concentrations of each, we can associate that with different chemical uses of PFAS. So like a firefighting foam has a very specific fingerprint. So if we take a sample and we see that it has this fingerprint, we can start to look further into, you know, hey, this might be a firefighting foam. Maybe there was a spill somewhere that we weren't aware of. And other industries like that, like in one case, we're working with a town where they know that there are mobile dog groomers and some conditioners and shampoos are known to have PFAS in them. Once we get some sampling results, we'll be able to look and develop a fingerprint to say, okay, this likely is a conditioner. So let's start to have serious conversations with these mobile dog groomers about how they discharge and products they're using, because it could be something as simple as just finding a different conditioner and shampoo to use for the pups.
Eric, this has been so fascinating. Thank you so much for being here and talking with me today.
Thanks so much for having me. It's been a lot of fun. It's been really great.